Hello and welcome everybody, I'm Papa Varian and this is DevDare number 51 for Victoria 3. Today we have the tutorial, and I know that most people that watch these videos are actually very experienced grand strategy players, because otherwise, you know, you wouldn't be following this game before it even releases. These DevDaries are largely for us as an audience. So that being said, the tutorial seems a bit boring. I mean, most people have thousands of hours, or well, most people watching these videos surely have thousands of hours in these games and might not even want to do the tutorial. I would just like to say, please do pay attention, because this is a very important topic, both for you, but also for newer players. When I, for example, look at the grand strategy genre, right? I don't just look at Paradox, obviously, I look at all of those indie games. And trust me, there are many, many indie games or many indie developers that actually do grand strategy games, and most of them don't really fail because they're necessarily bad games. Obviously, you can always expand. It's a huge, it's a very deep genre where, you know, there's always room further down and further up. But most games like this fail because you have a new interface. You have an interface that doesn't have the technology, the lessons learned that Paradox interface have. And the result oftentimes is that instead of engaging and fighting with the mechanics, players actually fight, you know, with the UI, with even understanding where connections and such are. So with that in mind, I would just like to say that I think tutorials are one of the most important part, and that I very much hope, you know, this is basically just a conclusion already from this dev diary, I very much hope that other developers of any given grand strategy game look at what Paradox is doing and tries to understand why they're doing it. It is so, so important to get the tutorial right so that the player jumps in and right away actually fights with the mechanics rather than the actual interface and understanding what the mechanics even do. Now, Victoria 3 does the tutorial in a slightly different way than other games. I mean, just think of Hoi 3, where an anonymous painter would be aiding you in understanding the game. Think about all the other games, where it's just, hey, here's a tutorial scenario, you jump in and that's what you do, and then you're done with it, right? Never really engaging, never really fun. Seeker 3 already tried to do it differently. Obviously, you have the actual tutorial that you then can continue playing, but maybe more importantly, you are looking at the reactive advice that you can turn on and turn off in the options menu. And that one is fairly hands-off. It just tells you, hey, consider this, consider that, and then there you go. Now, Victoria 3 is going to take that a bit further. Let's take a look at what they're actually doing. Hi, I'm Aaron, UX designer on Victoria 3. I'm here to tell you all about our latest attempt to teach you how to play a Paradox game. God help me. Yeah, it's very understandable, I think. Grand strategy games, and this is also why the niche, why this genre is as small as it is on the wider scale of video games. It's just so damn hard to get into it. And, you know, maybe they found a way to make it at least a bit easier. Victoria 3 is by far our most complex and deep economic experience to date. Many of our mechanics and terms can be found in a real-world economy, and we have to take into account that the player might not intuitively know what tariffs, loan principal, or subsidies mean. But such specialized terminology is also the best way to describe the mechanics. Trade tax is just awkward and imprecise compared to tariff. We also have to keep in mind that many of you have your own interpretation of these terms, like our QA manager Paul, who, and this is a fact that I think most people are not aware of, conveniently has an economics degree. This is of course a big topic. I mean, as much as they can of course work on the tutorial, as much as the tutorial can be better, it has to be said, Victoria 3 will always be a hard to get into game. You have to make it as easy, as simple as possible, you know, because there's this difference between complexity that arises from the UI making it very difficult to understand what's going on, and complexity that exists because, well, the actual systems are complex. And if the systems are complex, then the UI needs to be as simple as it can be, or rather needs to put things into as simple a term as it can be. But if you do that in Victoria 3, you can never, for example, compete with something like CK3. I mean, I gotta be honest with you, and I actually like this about CK3 a lot, but when you look at CK3, everybody intuitively can understand, look at this, my character's compassionate, he's greedy, and maybe he's brave, so what would he do in this situation, what would he do in that situation? It is very easy to really understand what CK3 is about, which information is important and, you know, pivotal, and which information you can basically dismiss, whereas with Victoria 3, yeah, definitely a bit harder. If you remember, they are of course working on making it as easy as possible with the projection, for example, the estimate for if you build up this factory, how much money will it make, which people will be employed and so on, but ultimately it can't reach CK3 levels. Let's see how simple they can make it. In the end, this made us ask ourselves, is there a way we can make a solid tutorial that caters to as many players as possible, because of course, you know, everybody starts at a different level and so on. Learn the game your way. In Victoria 3, the tutorial works as its own player objective, named Learn the Game. A player objective is something you as a player can add on top of the normal sandbox experience provided by our GSG titles. Our game designer Nick will tell us more about details about player objectives next week, so that is next week's Dev Diary topic. Here we have four player objectives plus the sandbox, which has no objective. I think this is a really interesting scenario. Usually, when you have topics such as this one, so the very basics, learn the game, economic dominance, so basically how do you create an economy, then hegemon, which I assume is diplomacy and military, and then egalitarian society, which teaches you how to basically do the historical thing, at least to a certain rate, right, where you go from, for example, being absolute monarchy all the way to being a fairly equal society. These things usually are packaged in individual scenarios that you open up and then you do it and then you close it. In this case, they actually just let you play the game while being accompanied by this. I really like this base approach because it makes the game, basically, in any other tutorial scenario view, you would be getting in a situation where you need to play 3 hours of closed scenarios that finish after you finish the tutorial, and then you can actually play. With this approach, you can simply just play. You start the game, you pick a nation, whether it is a recommended one, you're going to see that in a second or not, and then you can jump in. Very, very smart. It's a reactive accompanying tutorial rather than a tutorial that says, I start here, I finish there, and that's all you need to do with me. For example, and I actually think it's a really good game for what it is. I believe it is developed by one person, so definitely bravo, right? That's just remarkable. Star Dynasties is a game that you may have heard of. It's basically a turn-based board game, if you will, but it's more into the CK direction than into the Solaris direction. Very, very neat. But I haven't played it in a while because doing the tutorial would require me to play one of those fairly close scenarios, although this one is also, it has a hint of what is going on here in Victoria, right? So quite the good work there. But you have to jump in and play that for 2 hours to remember what is going on. This one tries to just put you into gameplay so that it sticks with you naturally. When you choose to learn the game objective in Wiki, you do not sacrifice your first game of Victoria 3 to a handheld tutorial experience of the game. The game will start off and work in mostly the same manner as if you started with any other objective or without an objective. You know, let me actually scroll down here. I previously mentioned that the game will work. Right, we're gonna get to that in a second. We're gonna see what this footnote means right there. You may pick whatever country you want, though we do provide a couple of recommended countries that can be considered potentially easier starting countries in regards to typical gameplay and amount of things to manage. Like all historical Paradox Friends strategy games, countries start off in very different positions, and playing your first game with a landlocked single province vassal state with nothing but subsistence farmers might not be the ideal learning experience, though we won't prevent you from trying. So they are basically saying, you click learn the game, you get this, and then you could say, okay, I'm going to select one of these two, or I'm going to play with this player objective, but play a different country. I really like that. What I can't see right here, actually, I can't see how you would start the player objective with a different country, because you can see that you can only select these two. Oh, select any country. I'm just blind. My apologies. Yeah. Play a campaign guided by challenges that help you learn both how the game works and how to play it. The following game rules are recommended. AI behavior towards player lenient and AI aggression low. Right. We're going to see this explained later as well. So that's pretty neat. You can actually modify that in the game rules. I'm a big, big fan of that. Sweden. After losing Finland and gaining Norway in a personal union, Sweden has begun the slow process of industrialization, while also becoming more liberal in some ways. What does the future of Sweden hold? Definitely a very easy, very neat way to start, you know, with Sweden when you want to learn the basics of the game. In this time period, Sweden had a very, very quiet time. Nobody really came for Sweden. If you want to, you know, for example, form Scandinavia, of course you're free to do that, but nobody is your natural enemy that is going to try and destroy you. You know, compare that to, for example, Krakow, compare that to, for example, the German miners. There is a lot more going on right there. And then we have America. The United States of America have asserted the America's right to independence from European powers. However, the nation is also in the process of forcibly removing thousands of Native Americans from their homelands. What will the future for the United States look like? Now, the US in this time period, of course, they have the struggle in the West with the Native Americans and also with Mexico, but beyond that, I mean, Britain isn't really going to mess with them. None of the other European powers are interested in messing with them. America also a fairly simple start right there. In Victoria 2, America was quite boring because, of course, primarily, you know, the economy would be handled by the AI. The classic Victoria 2 tutorial nation is, of course, Brazil, not as in the actual tutorial, but more in what is recommended. Brazil is ignored by everybody as most of South America is in most of these games. But yeah, these are the suggested nations, and you could select any country to go and learn the game. This is a very open process. In CK3, you have the actual tutorial, and that tutorial is, of course, set in Munster. And you can continue playing that tutorial. That scenario can be continued, right, as you jump in, and you can just continue that playthrough. But it is very, very limited. You can't say, you know what, I want to learn the basics of the game, but in Persia. The CK3 tutorial is scripted. Again, they have the other nature of this as well, where they have the reactive advice that you can turn off and turn on, but the actual tutorial, definitely not as free as this one. I like this a lot. I think this should open up the game, should make people understand what is happening on a very basic level, whether you're new or not. You can jump in and say, okay, while I play, just advise me on this particular topic, but I will just play. Very much, I think, the right approach right here. If you start your very first game of Victoria 3 as America with Learn the Game as your player objective, you are greeted by an optional introductory pop-up that will walk you through the basic UI controls, main UI elements, and how to unpause the game. You'd be surprised how many first-time Paradox players do not find out how you unpause your games. Kind of funny, but I guess it's not that easy if you have never touched Grand Strategy at this point. I mean, Grand Strategy, you know, when I started playing it, there were like 10 buttons max at any given moment, and now it's there's a lot going on. The UI has gotten a lot better to really, you know, deal with the complexity that has been added since the old games, but man, yeah, it's not that easy, especially if you've never seen it. After that, the reactive journal system takes over and handles most of the tutorial as you move through the game. Let's talk about reactive journals. Right, before we get to the reactive journal system, let's quickly take a look at the pop-up right here. It details that we are Andrew Jackson, that things are about to get crazy, because the Congress of Vienna has left behind an old order that is, of course, fostering unrest here, because, you know, it's making nobody really happy. It just establishes what had been the case before Napoleon. But things are about to change, and then it says there's no one way to win in Victoria 3. You set your own goals and experience different stories in the process of pursuing them. Now, in this pop-up, we have a skip lesson and a next button, meaning if you think, you know, whatever this pop-up might have to tell you isn't interesting, you can skip it. Which, interestingly enough, brings us to the reactive journal system. As I hinted at above, there are two major components to the tutorial experience. The reactive journal entries complemented by short pop-up tutorial lessons. The first is a set of challenges for you to accomplish that will be delivered via the journal system. Completing or sometimes failing these challenges proves to the game that you have learned the fundamentals of the mechanic that we're trying to teach you and permits you to proceed in the tutorial. Basically, you have a small goal. That goal then has advisory pop-ups, you know, that let you know, hey, maybe you're interested in this. And when you have enough of the information that these pop-ups can give you, you can execute what you just learned. And once you execute it, of course, you're looking at actually achieving the goal. Pretty straightforward, pretty organic, and it can be in any given playthrough. If you are interested in this tutorial, you can do it as the US, as Sweden, as Prussia, and so on. Because obviously, these are general mechanical lessons that are being taught to you. Very interesting. Early challenges are in the form of expand a farm and teach you basic UI navigation and the surface layer of the construction mechanics. Later challenges could be increase GDP by 10% or elevate your power rank, so something that is grander and requires you to understand the basic lessons. You can already see it right here. Expand a farm would obviously work towards your GDP being increased, meaning you learn A and then you can move on to B, which require more long-term commitment and integration of many skills you've learned so far. I like this approach so much. It's such a free-form approach that just lets you play the game and doesn't let you miss out on any information either. To the greatest extent possible, we attempt to cater these challenges to your situation. For example, if you play the tutorial of Sweden, you'll be tasked to expand a rye farm as your first challenge, while if you play it as Sokoto, it will be a millet farm. Similarly, when you are asked to improve relations with a certain country, we try to select a country where your efforts won't be wasted. Our aim here is to not just have you go through the motions, but actually benefit from the challenges you complete. This is the only thing, or one of the few things in this tutorial dev diary, where I'm like, this could be a source for disaster. Obviously, the actual structure of this tutorial makes it so that it is as non-intrusive as it can be, and that you can tailor it to yourself without having to evaluate your full potential, right? When Civ, for example, that is the game that comes to mind for me initially, where I really don't like the tutorials, I think they're not that good, and they always say, how experienced are you with these games, right? It's difficult to really ascertain how experienced you are. Let's say you come back to this genre after 6 years not playing. I don't know, where are you, right? This is less intrusive, but it always is basically by your side and says, I can give you info if you need it. I like this, but If there are any bugs in this tutorial, if this tutorial selects the wrong building and then you have a challenge, you have a mission that you can't complete, if this tutorial selects a nation that is really not relevant to you, you might end up with a situation where a player gets the wrong thing taught to them. Ultimately, this is a concern that can be addressed by them, you know, simply really going through the motions of the tutorial, by having the tutorial in a very safe fashion when it comes to the actual code that gets executed, right? How is the country selected that you need to improve relationships with, etc., etc. But I definitely think this is a big, big trap and they need to be careful. This needs to be perfect. If a new player comes in here and says, you know what? My friend told me about this. My friend has 6,000 hours in a Europa Universalis phone. They said Victoria 3 is a great game. I'm going to play it. But the game says, please build a rocket factory. And it's the year 1836. Then that player might never come back to the game. This is a big risk factor here without a doubt. But it will work. I mean, who knows? I got to tell you, I think in CK3, the reactive advice, definitely what I see in the YouTube comments when, you know, for example, in my tutorial videos, when people talk about it, they generally are positive towards the in-game tools. But you know, for example, in the Warfare tutorial for CK3, people oftentimes go, I didn't understand it like this at all in the game, but now I know much better. So this has weaknesses, don't get me wrong here. This is just the biggest concern that I have, even though, of course, I think, you know, the weaknesses are very much overshadowed by the greatness that this potential, very non-intrusive journal system can have. Let's take a look at the journal entries that we have right here. Learn the game, so this is its own category, so that you can very quickly, you know, identify, is this something that is actually happening in the game, or is this something that the tutorial is throwing at me? What do we have here? Fix capacity deficit. Restore bureaucracy balance. Okay, fair enough. Increase market access by decree. Very easy. It's a one-step thing, right? You do in Virginia for 12 weeks, so you do it and then you just let it happen. You see, right, this makes sense. You, by making it happen, and by having it run for 12 weeks, I believe the decree will probably cost authority, right? You will see that it's using up your capacity. You will see whether you go over capacity. This is actually a pretty good lesson. I can see what's happening here. GDP increased by -150k. Yeah, they're not having a good time, I think. I think the US in this playthrough is currently struggling a bit. But this is interesting. This is a more generalistic mission. This is a very direct one. This is a generalistic one. Then we have the improved supply network. Is this to do with infrastructure in general? So trains, for example, or is this to do with the convoys? I'm not entirely sure. Improve access to consumer goods. I assume you make them, you know, a bit less expensive, and these consumer goods then are in a position where you actually have better access, of course, because more people can afford it. Tutorial challenges aren't completely linear, but do spawn in a logical sequence. For example, you won't be given the challenge to increase the investment into an institution until you have actually enacted a law that enables an institution. In some cases, a previous challenge sets up the preconditions for completing a subsequent challenge, and in other cases, later challenges build up on concepts that you have learned about in prior challenges. This is handled by a kind of pacing system that underlies the objectives mechanic, which we will also learn more about next week. Very interested in the objectives mechanic as a whole, because obviously these are journal systems, these are objectives that you have for to learn the game, sort of approach here. But surely objectives also exist outside of the tutorial area. I would be very interested to find out how that actually works, and maybe even what modability is, or can be tailored around it. For example, I can think of Anbinar. Anbinar could surely benefit from this. It's not a mission tree and it's not supposed to be one, but Anbinar, since it comes from EU4, definitely relies heavily on it, and I would be interested in seeing what they do with a less mission tree-y system, but still missions. Now here we have the footnote. I previously mentioned that Learn the Game will work mostly the same as any regular sandbox game, with the addition of the learning challenges. There are some subtle differences, such as the AI being reluctant to start diplomatic plays against you before you prove you have a handle on the basic economic and political aspects of the game. So outside of this, I think these are two different things. You have this suggested game rule, where it says AI behavior towards players lenient and AI aggression low, but I believe that is separate from this very specific case where it says until you master the very basic things, there won't be diplomatic plays against you. This is something where the AI is curtailed on top of the already existing gameplay rule. At least that is how I interpret it. I think it's fine. This is Learn the Game, right? So this is the very first one. Right, yeah, this is the very first objective. So obviously, they have to be held back here. I assume that is not the case for economic dominance, hegemon, and egalitarian society, as those are much more advanced. Very interesting. I like it. Obviously, it's still, you can jump into this playthrough, you can continue it, but it is easy on you because you are fairly fresh into it. For the learn the game objective, this includes lowered AI aggressiveness by default, right? These are the game rules that can be overwritten, though you can always choose to ignore this default and increase it before starting your campaign if you prefer. Perhaps you learn best through repeated failure. Yeah, that is how I learned these games. You have a lot of time to waste as a kid, right? The second aspect of the tutorial are pop-up walkthroughs that deliver explanatory information or guide you through the user interface. This will be highly reminiscent of the classic linear tutorial experience, where the next bit of information or instruction is unlocked by you navigating to and clicking a specific highlighted button in the interface. This is what CK3 did in its actual tutorial, in the Munster tutorial. The difference between the classic linear tutorial, so also CK3's tutorial, and our approach is that these lessons are short, modular, and usually player-triggered. Each tutorial journal entry has up to two pop-up tutorials called Tell Me How and Tell Me Why. The How will guide you through the interface to show you which buttons to press to complete the task, the simpler challenges, or show you where you can find the information to solve the problem for more complex ones. Obviously, to build a farm, it can show you the button. To increase GDP, it needs to tell you the concept of GDP, why it matters, what influences it, and what you can do. That's a bit more than just a button. The why will tell you the often crucial bit of information of why you would want to do a certain thing and what effect this might have. Makes perfect sense. They do illustrations here, and I'm not so sure about these illustrations, but let's take a quick look at this. Why expand buildings? Expanding a building such as wheat farms increases how many pops can work there, and enriches the rest of your country's pops by giving them access to grain at a lower cost than before. I would like country pops to, like, maybe have a different turn. Like what I would enjoy here. Building means more workforce, means more grain, means more pop wealth, right? I would like to see this because right here I'm not really... Yeah, I like the graphical depiction, this sort of flow chart, right? But I do definitely think that something that is a bit clearer than just workforce or grain would help. But then again, it's just images. The actual information is, of course, to be found in the UI whenever you play the game. This is just for the tutorial right here. You can trigger any of these in any order you like or not. In many cases, especially if you're well-versed with Paradox games or strategy games in general, you might want to solve the simpler challenges with no guidance at all, just by clicking through the menus and figuring it out. Many players might want to click Tell Me Why to get a more in-depth explanation of every feature as they first engage with them, but you can also skip past it and read up on it later in our in-game Wikipedia or online wiki. The in-game Wikipedia, the concept textbook, very, very good. CK3 has it. I want more of that in any given grand strategy game. Nested tooltips were the greatest thing ever established. The, you know, internal game concept library is the second best thing that they've done. Now let's take a look at this. How to fix a capacity deficit. We had that mission early on, and then here they will explain it. Much like your budget, your three capacities have inflows and outflows. The value you see at the top of the screen is the size of your excess or deficit. Instead of accumulating, the balance is converted into a positive effect if above zero, and a negative effect if below zero. The negative effect is much more severe than the positive, so it is usually better to allocate your capacities up to the limit than to maintain a high positive balance. However, it is always very bad to run a deficit, and you will want to correct that as soon as possible. So here you get explained. Why would you, or how do you fix it, and what does it do, right? The very basics. A lesson telling you why expanding a basic building is a safe investment. Let's take a look at this. A safe way of growing your economy is by expanding a basic resource building that produces a staple good like grain. Staples are consumed directly by most of your pops, who will buy it from the productive building. This enriches its workforce, so you can tax to earn money for the treasury. These funds can be used to expand other parts of your industry. We will use your wheat farm in New York as an example. However, your mouse over the state... hover your mouse over the state name, New York. This will highlight its location somewhere on the map of the United States of America. I really like that they actually grabbed a very specific farm. I like that. This is very... You know, I talked about it earlier, with the difficulty where it might, if there is an issue in how it is coded, how it selects something, I think that could be a negative thing that really misleads people, but when it works... I think it's much better than, hello, the general building of wheat farms do X and Y. Instead, they say, look at that. This is what this building is doing for you in New York right now. This is much, much better. Much more hands-on. Big, big fan. Click on the state of New York on the map. Pop-up walkthroughs are not only associated with tutorial journal entries. Some are triggered at key points in the tutorial, such as when you complete a challenge and in the very beginning of the Learn the Game objective, just to teach you the basics of moving the map around, clicking buttons and the main HUD. They are also wired up to a few key concepts. If you encounter such a concept in-game that you'd like to learn about more in-depth and hands-on, you can trigger a tutorial right from the concept tooltip anytime. Now this is something CK3 doesn't have. I wish it did. This is cool. Let's say you jump into the game, you know, 5 DLCs later, you haven't played in ages, you don't know what the new feature is, but you don't really want to do the tutorial. All you need to do is click on that concept, boom, they're gonna tell you about struggles, for example, in Iberia for CK3's newest DLC. Very, very cool stuff. This is the expansion of what CK3 did right, and I think it's a great approach right here. Look at this, for example, interest groups. And of course, you can always do the nested tooltips. You can see country, attraction, cloud, political strength, all of those can be nested tooltipped. But maybe more importantly, you can click this button, guide me, and then you get a full explanation what interest groups actually are. Very neat. A political faction within your country that share a common interest. They are supported by pops in relation to their attraction to them, and the clout they enjoy is based directly on the supporting pop's political strength. Interest groups have numbers of ideologies, causing them to endorse or oppose different laws. They also have 3 interest group traits that are activated and on different approval levels. Their leader's personal ideology also rubs off on the interest group. So that is the short of it, and here we have it in long form. What are interest groups? An interest group is a faction within your country whose pop supporters share political interest. Interest groups can have 1 of 3 different statuses in your country. In government, part of the ruling class, whether by free election, divine right, violent force or other means. In opposition, asserting their influence outside of the halls of power and marginalized, not strong enough to matter, dormant for all intents and purposes. Like for example, very early on, I assume the trade union. All countries have the same kinds of interest groups, but many have unique variations depending on historical, cultural or religious conditions. You obviously have a religious group, you know, for example, in Prussia, they are the Protestant Church. And then on the other hand, in China, for example, you would maybe have Confucian monks, for example, right? This is very, very interesting because it is a universal system that allows for customization per country, but always has you do and start out by fully understanding this is my religious group, this is my military group. I like that approach because it is universal and yet unique in the individual countries. When we designed the tutorial system, we had 3 main goals. It should cater to as many unique learning styles and degrees of prior experience as possible. It should be integrated with a regular gameplay experience, not by a separate mode players have to go through to get to the game. And it should be modular and future-proof, so we don't have to rewrite the flow of the whole thing when we add or change mechanics. Tutorial update neglect is one of the worst things, but one of the most common things in grand strategy games, be that Paradox or anybody else. When you look at these design pillars, for tutorial systems, ultimately, for the entire UX, right? This makes it clear every bit, every button, every image, every text bubble in the game needs to satisfy these 3 main goals. Most people that, you know, have different learning styles need to be able to engage with it. It needs to be fitting in with the actual gameplay experience, and it needs to be future-proof. I, at this point, have come to an opinion, and I don't think this is shared by most people, but I've come to the opinion that UX and telling people about mechanics matters more than the actual complexity of mechanics. If you neglect UX, people can't actually engage with the mechanics as they constantly have to work through, you know, something that denies them actively playing the game. If you neglect mechanics, at worst, you have a slightly flat mechanic. Obviously, you want deep mechanics as much as possible, but one necessitates the other, whereas bad UX is always truly awful. Bad mechanics, you know, they can be at least stomachable if the UX around them is satisfying. I think that they are doing this with this approach as well. They're basically saying the UX comes in and it plays such a major role because it has to do everything to really let the mechanics carry the game. Without the UX, the mechanics fall apart as well because the player can't even really associate with them. These final thoughts here, these 3 main goals, very, very important. And I can only hope that if people are making like a grand strategy indie game, which I mean, hopefully, you know, make more of them and make infinite ones out there. But when people are making them, that they are looking at Paradox tech and copy as much as possible in the sense that they learn from it, that they try to expand on it, that they ask themselves, is this the quality that they are doing? Can I do it better? Because I think most small grand strategy games die because they do not recognize these main goals. They don't understand rope people in, you need to make it easy for them with these three main goals. This is a big dev diary for me personally, because it really shows just how much Paradox actually focuses on tutorials and, you know, UX, and puts new approaches in where other games still do the, alright, click the tutorial button, and now for 3 hours you're gonna be reading text boxes, baby. That approach needs to go away. We need something that actually works intuitively, rather than something where you study for a test. Let's continue with the end of this dev diary. Based on our own experiences as avid strategy gamers, that's what I talked about earlier, or well, what's coming up now is what I talked about earlier, games that force the player to make an initial self-selection of novice, intermediate and expert player profiles to funnel them into the appropriate tutorial track often end up off base. I always say, give me little advice in Total War games, and I never need the advice. I'm never interested in anything that the random pop-up has to say, and when I'm interested in something, the random pop-up isn't there for me. That is my experience with this, with Civ. It's always this way for me. I know most of the mechanics intuitively or because I've already played these games, but when there is a mechanic that I'm not fully aware of, I need to Google it. That's something that can't be... You can't do that anymore. It's just not good enough. With players assessing themselves incorrectly or more advanced tracks leaving critical knowledge gaps. Yeah, that's exactly my experience. Instead, we figured, why don't we ask the player what type of information they want in the context of whatever they're trying to learn, even if you're not in the tutorial. At any given moment, you can say, you know what, teach me about interest groups. I forgot how they work, I don't know, you know, didn't read the dev diary, didn't watch the dev diary video. You can do that here, rather than, oh, how do I get into the tutorial for interest groups? This is way better. We need this seriously in all of the games that are coming out now that are grand strategy, otherwise you just can't access them unless you have a lot of time on your hands. Instead, we figured, right, why don't ask for the information they want in the context of whatever they're trying to learn. Similarly, while a tightly scripted and funnel tutorial with perfectly controlled variables might be easier to craft a novice learning experience around, we didn't want players to skip the tutorial because they wouldn't be able to play the campaign they wanted to, or cancel it halfway through and restart because they felt they'd learned enough. So, we thought, if we get the player to tell us they want to learn the game as an objective, we can serve up suitable dynamic challenges with optional guides, and everything else is simply pure gameplay. I love that. This seriously is something, and I know I'm repeating myself, but if there's even a single person out there that is developing grand strategy games that are indie or not Paradox games, whatever, you need to study this stuff. You need to steal as much as you can, okay? This is the tech advantage that Paradox naturally has from developing grand strategy games for 20 years. It's excellent, so much better, and in 10 years, I mean, you know, we're gonna say this was really bad, but for the moment, this is really good and more people need to copy this approach, this design philosophy behind tutorials. Finally, with this approach, we can add or change individual challenges and tutorials along with updates to mechanics without having to worry about shoehorning learning about this new mechanic somewhere in the middle of a linear tutorial. This makes actual, you know, keeping up with tutorials easier. Rebalancing this tutorial and perhaps most importantly, forcing existing players to replay the tutorial to learn about the new stuff. Crusader Kings 3 was the first PDX game to implement a reactive tutorial, which triggers an informational window when the player first encounters a new mechanic. This may sound straightforward, but was a big step forward for us in terms of proactive explanation of new game mechanics in our highly interconnected and evolving games. In Victoria 3, we have taken this concept and expanded it, such that we can embed entire tutorial flows into new game concepts that lead the player through the interface of a new mechanic in depth and on demand. Oh, you know what? Yeah, actually, now I remember this. Oh my god. I almost forgot about this, but CK3 obviously has that tutorial about Ireland, but CK3 does do a reactive... Oh, you want to know about this? Let me tell you about this sort of thing that they're talking about here for the Royal Court content. The Royal Court actually does exactly this. Oh yeah, so CK3 is working on implementing the lessons that are now being created in Victoria 3. Very, very interesting. In addition, we can add more challenges and tutorial flows into the existing Learn the Game objective and even add new objectives that incorporate challenges to teach major new features. So, when at any given point, supranational institutions like the League of Nations, the Commonwealth and such make it into the game, you can just say, I will add objectives, I will add these guides right here, and maybe I will add a learning scenario, right? But it will always be present as a thing that can just pop up as you learn the game. Very, very interesting. Seriously, this approach is something that more games need to pick up. But we will learn more about that next week, so new objectives, when our game designer Nick tells us about how objectives work. Very excited for that one as well. I hope that my take on the situation really has come across, because it's something that both frustrates me a lot, but also matters a lot to me when it comes to grand strategy games, having really followed, actively, very proactively followed the Crusader Kings 3 modding community. It's an amazing community, the best modding community hands down that we have for Paradox, but having followed them, the biggest downfall for most mods isn't that they have bad ideas for mechanics, or that they don't know what they're doing. There are outstanding modders out there. It's that they don't think through what a UI needs to be doing. They're great about it, they have gotten way, way better, but that is the easiest pitfall for any mod. That is the easiest pitfall for any third-party game, and so on. And what Paradox is doing right here, what they're telling us about in this dev diary, is something that if you're a modder, if you're a game developer, you really should take to heart. This is a developer talking about their tech, about what they have learned from making grand strategy games for 20 years, and why they're doing things the way they are. I really like what they're doing here. I hope that, for example, a mod that introduces a new mechanic, and I know so many for CK3, submission to authority comes to mind, you know, the prisoner transfer, all that stuff comes to mind, that they can take the way this is structured and implement it for their own mods as well. Just imagine, for example, and I love coming back to this one, but just imagine, for example, a Sunless Sea mod, and there's a new mechanic that is related to, for example, sunlight. Why not just say, we have reactive pop-ups, we have a reactive guide for how sunlight works. It shows you all the buttons, it shows you where things are, boom. All of a sudden, you don't have to watch any tutorial videos, you don't have to look up any mod Wikipedias and so on, you can just do it in the game. Big, big fan. I really hope that this is something where the community, but also other devs, look at it twice or maybe even three times. For the moment, this is it. Let me know what you thought about this tutorial content, whether you are happy about the tutorials, whether you maybe prefer the old style of tutorials. I'm a big fan of this. Again, it just really needs to be exact when it comes to how, you know, an objective and so on is chosen. But beyond that, very, very cool stuff. And I'll see you later, alligator.